You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
What's up, Wisconsin? How y'all doing on this fall-like Monday? Fall has arrived here in Wisconsin. Folks, I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We got a big show for you today. Very excited. I'm going to be joined by Will Ragland, who is the Vice President of Research, Advocacy, and Outreach for the Center for American Progress Action Fund. We're going to be talking about, you know, Donald Trump likes to paint himself as the champion of American manufacturing. Turns out that's actually a big old fatty lie. And Will and I will dig into that. You're not going to want to miss that. At 3 o'clock, of course, it is Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money. This one I'm really excited about. I'm going to be joined by woman by the name of Sarah Chase. She is a reporter. She's done, everything from reporting for National Public Radio in Paris to covering the fall and resurgence of the Taliban in Afghanistan. So very, very interesting set of experiences. She's also served as a special advisor to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. So this lady knows what is up. And what we're going to be talking about today is corruption. What does modern day corruption look like? And coming on the heels of my interview with Heather Cox Richardson last Friday, which if you missed it, you do want to go check that out. Heather Cox Richardson has the number one Substack. It's called Letters from an American. And we really kind of dug into why is it that Donald Trump seems so obsessed with tariffs? Like, where is this coming from? And where does this sit in a historical context? And it turns out tariffs, often a tool of the corrupt. And by that, I mean not strategic, well-placed tariffs that are, frankly, a tool of foreign policy as well as an economic tool. I'm talking about these sort of widespread tariffs that Donald Trump is endorsing for his second term. Yeah, it turns out we've been there, done that. And it led to basically the burdening of the middle class, the decimation of the middle class and the Great Depression. And it was all part of a scheme cracked up by the monopolists, the trust organizers of the Gilded Age, the robber barons and the steel magnates to basically make the middle class pay for everything. And here we find ourselves again. So this discussion today with Sarah about corruption, modern corruption, I think is incredibly timely, especially when you consider the fact that Donald Trump has flouted a number of ethical norms, not just while he was in office, of course, but in anticipation of a potential second term. And I wanted to share all of this with you, and I'm going to get there this afternoon. Like, Donald Trump is already potentially engaging in all sorts of violations of conflict of interest rules. Okay. I'm going to explain all that to you. Like, it is happening already. He doesn't need to, you know, take an oath and actually win an election for him to already be creating ethical concerns, conflict of interest concerns, as the GOP's number one presidential top of the ticket guy. And as we see, it looks like most polls, things are tightening up. By the way, nobody should be freaking out about that. If you're freaking out, call me 855-752-4842. I will talk you off the ledge. But as we see this race tighten up, his flouting of some of these normal practices that are engaged by the top candidates from both the Democratic Party as well as the Republican Party in anticipation of potentially becoming the president is really concerning. So I'm going to talk about that before we get out of this half hour. I want to share that with you. If you've got some feelings or some instincts about this, as well as any sorts of knee-jerk reactions to the polls, I want to hear from you. 855-752-4842. That's 855-75-CIVIC. But what I want to start with today, first off, is mark your calendar. This Friday is probably going to be the one and the only Hovde Baldwin debate. The Wisconsin Broadcasters Association is hosting these debate, probably the only one between Senator Tammy Baldwin and carpetbagger, 100 millionaire, doesn't really live in Wisconsin, Eric Hovde. I should also say doesn't really know much about anything. Eric Hovde, he just kind of makes things up. And Civic Media is going to have that debate live. It's coming up on Friday. So mark your calendars, really, really, really critical. But it's interesting, you know, we're about to enter into the early voting period or the absentee voting period here in the state of Wisconsin. And I'm going to take some time this week to go through and answer the most common, I think, basic questions about voting. I'm going to go through that just step by step so that y'all have all of the information that you need. You're going to want to have a pen and paper for that when we do that a little later this week. But one of the ways when you vote early, you can do that in person. It's called in-person early voting or in-person absentee voting. You can also request a ballot to be mailed to you. And you can either turn that ballot in by hand to your local clerk's office, or you can mail it in, or in some jurisdictions, there are drop boxes where you can drop your ballot off that you received early. And these drop boxes have been used in Wisconsin for decades. No problem. But all of a sudden, right, in 2020, because of COVID, because Democrats didn't lie about COVID, more Democratic-leaning voters were more likely to use mail-in ballots and drop boxes than were conservatives. So conservatives created a big old fat election lie about like, oh, drop boxes aren't secure. Had them for 20 plus years, no problem. But all of a sudden, everybody got all freaked out about them and Donald Trump spread a bunch of lies about drop boxes. Of course, now the ironic thing is Republicans are telling their people to vote early. But what's happened in the state of Wisconsin regarding drop boxes is really, really disgusting. First of all, you had the sheriff in Dodge County basically bullying city clerks into not using drop boxes. And of course, we had the mayor of Wausau with his dolly just walking off with the drop box. That was bad, too. Apparently, all that being investigated by the attorney general. We'll see what happens there. But we also had our good friend Jeff Mandel from Law Forward in Wisconsin on last week. And Jeff talked about the fact that there's this federal lawsuit that has been going on related to two small towns in northern Wisconsin. And basically, the lawsuit happened because they refused to use accessible voting machines, digital voting machines. So now here's the sort of like third attack, right? You got the guy with the dolly rolling the drop box away. You got the sheriff bullying to not use drop boxes. And now, you know, like drop boxes, especially helpful for older people, people that have trouble getting around, people that may be disabled, right? Because you can get your voting done early. You're not going to be stuck waiting in a line. And now here in these small towns, we have yet another attack on common sense voting machinery that will make it harder for disabled people to vote. So Thornapple, back in the spring, decided, oh, we're not going to use voting machines. No. What? It makes it much harder. If you have a disability, you get, those paper ballots and the little Scantron bubbles. Like, I have a hard time doing it. I'm 47. I need my readers.
I need my readers.
Oh, my goodness. Can't see any of that stuff. But the voting machines are really easy. They're touch screen. They're not hooked up to the internet. They're air gapped. And then it prints out a ballot that is perfectly legible that their machine readers can count. Except Thornapple, who had just bought these machines and they're not cheap, decided, oh, yeah, well, we're just not going to use those. And so here is the tape, like the tape that is the focus of these federal lawsuits. And I'm going to give you an update when we come back. I'm going to talk about Trump's corruption that's already starting for his potential second administration, second presidency. But we're going to probably go out to this sound, but I want you to listen to what's happening here. This is a woman by the name of Erin Webster. She's the Rusk County Democratic Party chairwoman, and she's talking to a supervisor from Thornapple about why they've stopped using the accessible voting machines. Okay? And yeah, he says the quiet part out loud. Let's take a listen.
Well, we made that decision and we're going to stand with it.
So why was that decision made?
Because we believe that there was a stolen election, and the computers have to go because they're full of error.
Those are brand new machines.
I don't care how new they are. And I'm not going to get into that point. We made that decision. We're going to stay with that.
So you are not having ballot reading machines at the Thornapple Township because you believe the presidential election was stolen?
What was the point? We counted everything by hand anyhow.
So how was the election stolen if you counted everything by hand? The last presidential election was not counted by hand. So this is a partisan issue. And the reason you don't have those machines out is because you believe that your election was stolen.
There are court cases right now that show that anybody can hack and manipulate that machine within just a matter of a couple of minutes.
So you're also a conspiracy believer.
She points it out. Yeah, what he just said, this elected official from Thornapple, is absolutely a lie and untrue. There were over 70 some lawsuits following 2020. All of them argued that there was some kind of fraud. Not a whit of evidence. Folks, I'm going to dig into the current status of that case and Trump's corruption when we get back.
I've always been the one to say the first goodbye.
That's a love in Wisconsin. Welcome back, y'all. Or welcome if you're just joining us. My name is Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We've been talking about the fact that Republicans just seem to not want to grapple with facts or reality. And they engage and promote and repeat all sorts of wild, completely baseless conspiracy theories about voting. And we've seen, again, the Dodge County Sheriff bullying clerks to not have drop boxes. The mayor of Wausau dallying off with the drop box. Do, 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 do. And, these two towns, very small towns in Wisconsin, one the town of Lawrence, the other the Thornapple Township, all of a sudden saying, we're not going to use these very expensive voting machines that make it easier for disabled people to vote. And usually governments get a lot of discretion about how they're going to run these elections, except when you say on a recorded call that you're not using the very expensive voting machines that make it easier for disabled people to vote because the election in 2020 was stolen. But just stolen in the states that Joe Biden won and nowhere else. it's all just hooey. And here's the incredible thing. So the town of Lawrence has settled with the federal government because the DOJ had to sue these towns to try to ensure that disabled people can vote. Thornapple doesn't settle. And a federal judge entered an order last week saying you have to use these voting machines. You have to. And they also must, quote, cooperate fully with efforts by Wisconsin officials to enforce federal law. They've got to post signs informing people that accessible machines are available and allow DOJ officials to enter polling places so they can monitor them for compliance. Oh, but Tom Zelm, the acting chairman of Thornapple's town board, said last Thursday the issue had not yet been settled. Quote, in my book, it's still in litigation. That's the way I see it. No, sir, there's a standing court order from a federal court judge that commands you to do certain things. And that's what your oath means. You know, when you say, I will observe the U.S. Constitution and the state constitution, and I will faithfully execute the laws they're under. Yeah, it means following federal court orders. So no, it's not, quote, still in litigation. But this is the sort of nonsense that just boils my blood. Oh, remember that other like conspiracy theory that they all cracked up back from 2000? It was like, oh, Mark Zuckerberg, through a charity foundation, helped to try to provide funding to jurisdictions to help run the election because we needed a lot more people because it was COVID back in 2020. And they all freaked out about that. Oh, but if Elon Musk does it, it's completely fine. I mean, this is reporting last week from the Journal Sentinel. A political action committee led by tech billionaire Elon Musk has taken over a big share of the get out the vote efforts in Wisconsin in support of former President Trump. So again, there are two sets of rules when it comes to Republicans. The rules that Democrats have to play by, and those will be strictly enforced. And then the rules that they play by, which is whatever they say they are. Oh, and by the way, unless they win, then Democrats broke the rules. I mean, this is the insanity. There's only one outcome that they'll ever abide by, and it's Donald Trump winning. That is not democracy. Here we actually try to count the votes. At least we're supposed to. We're supposed to encourage people to vote, make it easier. Hey. And here's the corruption, the flouting of the norms, right? The different rules for Republicans than Democrats is happening already, even in this lead up to a possible Trump presidency 2.0. This is Ken Bensinger from the New York Times pointed out that Trump's team has refused to participate in the preparations for a transition to a potential second Trump presidency. Normally, what happens, and this is a nonpartisan transition process that's dictated by the Presidential Transition Act. Oh, yeah, that's what it's called. Fancy that. And candidates typically set up teams about 6 months ahead, and they begin vetting and doing the background checks for political appointees and working with the current administration to make sure that agencies continue to run smoothly. But Trump won't do this. He hasn't identified any potential political appointments. He's not participating in the process. And he refuses to sign the specific agreements that specify the transition plan's ethical rules. Because this would also require him to disclose private donors for his inauguration plans. And it limits those contributions to no more than $5,000. So, yeah. Kamala Harris, you do that. You sign that. You abide by these ethical rules. Donald Trump, no ethical rules for me. And without these agreements, his people can't start getting vetted, no background checks. They can't receive confidential national security briefings, which would have commenced. And, oh, by the way, there are no limits to the amount of money that the Trump transition can take. So, like, the corruption already beginning. Boggles the mind, if you will. Mark from Prairie du Sac, happy Monday, sir. What do you have to say this afternoon?
Happy Monday. Well, you got me all fired up once again. But I see that for the Trump Bible, that apparently I was writing my little thought that apparently it stops at the end of the Bill of Rights for the Constitution, ignoring the rest of the Constitution that, you know, the whole outlawing slavery and making, you know, African Americans full citizens and giving women the right to vote and 18-year-olds the right to vote, and that 14th Amendment, you know, actually says it's electoral, people actually select the electors. So then none of that apparently matters in the Trump Bible. I won't get into.
Yeah. And the idea that there's a Trump Bible? Who does this? President Obama said it best last week. Who does this? It's so weird. Listen, the federal government's going to have to, you know, descend on Thornapple, likely get a federal judge to mandate compliance. You may see sheriffs having to come into those polling places to enforce these court orders. It's a dark day. Folks, when we come back, really excited, I'm going to be joined by Will Ragland from the Center for American Progress Action Fund. He's the VP of Research, Advocacy, and Outreach. We're going to talk about Trump's failure to support American manufacturing. Join us here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Coming up next.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
What's up, Wisconsin and beyond? Welcome back. And welcome if you're just joining us. My name is Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Mondays at 2:30, I'm always excited to be joined by another really smart person from the Center for American Progress's Action Fund. And today is no exception. His name's Will Ragland. He's the Vice President for Research, Advocacy, and Outreach at the Center for American Progress Action Fund. He's had some pretty cool prior jobs, I thought, as well. He was the special assistant to former Education Secretary Arne Duncan's Office of Legislation and Congressional Affairs. I might have to ask you a couple of questions about that, too. Well, he also was on President Barack Obama's 2008 campaign research staff, and he also did research for the House Committee on Oversight and Reform. To all of you out there listening, do you work in manufacturing? Does someone in your family work in manufacturing? Are you proud of Wisconsin's strong manufacturing history? The fact that a lot of companies look to locate here because we've got such an incredible workforce. Do you want a president that supports American manufacturing? And by extension, the state of Wisconsin. Because if you do, you want to keep it locked for the segment with Will Ragland. Because listen, if you say that you support manufacturing Wisconsin, then we're going to want to know which of these presidential candidates, in Donald Trump and Kamala Harris, has enacted policies that actually help support American manufacturing. So really excited to have you here. Will, thanks so much for making time. These are the right questions, right? or are we framing this up incorrectly?
Oh, 100%. You know, I think that, you know, as far as Wisconsin is concerned, and I think you're going to bring it up again in a minute, there's no better example of what happened with Foxconn and what the Biden administration has helped come up and try and bridge the gap there with Microsoft. So we can get into more of that, but you know, Trump's MO has really failed promise after failed promise. We saw it in Lordstown in Ohio with auto jobs in Michigan, And the Biden administration, the Biden-Harris administration, really being able to walk the walk when it comes to the manufacturing game and their policies and what they've been able to not only create and help bring back jobs from overseas, but are also doing that in a way that is supported by the industries of the future.
Yeah, it's really interesting to me because, Will, this requires everybody listening, all of you out there, to actually get beyond what a candidate might say in a soundbite, right? Because this is Donald Trump's sort of now infamous MO. He'll basically say whatever he thinks is appealing to that particular constituency whose votes he's trying to get. But the reality of what he does is completely different. He speaks out of both sides of his mouth, and he enacts policies that don't help working people or those that work in manufacturing, but that help the corporate overlords, the biggest businesses. I mean, he told people back in 2016 that not a single manufacturing plant in this country was going to close. Was he true to that promise to the American worker?
No, we lost 200,000 manufacturing jobs, and we lost millions more overall. And if you look at some of the auto working job, auto worker jobs in particular, which he likes to focus on, it was another massive set of losses with plant after plant shutting down and sending jobs overseas. And in some way, he incentivized a lot of that to happen through two laws, through his Tax Cuts and Jobs Act and through his NAFTA 2.0, the U.S.-Mexico-Canada trade agreement. And combined, it really incentivized American-based corporations to move a number of jobs overseas with basically a 0% tax rate on foreign-made profits. And with the USMCA agreement, it kept a lot of flexibility and room for these factories to be built in Mexico. This is an argument that actually he repeats on the campaign trail over and over again, that there are new auto plants being built over the border in Mexico, when that is exactly what happened under his administration. And it's in large part due to two of his biggest legislative accomplishments when he was in office, which I always find interesting. With Trump, you can always look at his attacks, and there is some shred of something that he himself has done, right? He likes to try and turn his attacks around on things that he knows may implicate himself or his policies, and try to turn it around on his opponent. And this is one of those areas that makes me increasingly angry and frustrated, because of the success in large part that we've seen with bipartisan infrastructure law, the Inflation Reduction Act, the American Rescue Plan, and the CHIPS Act, which is really incentivized and worked with private industry to bring back jobs into the United States, good paying union jobs in large part. And there's a lot of work to do there. But if you look at, there's one of my favorite charts is the something that the Department of Labor measures, and that you can look at the Federal Reserve of St. Louis Bank, but it's basically a hockey stick of manufacturing construction investment over the years. And over the last 3 years, it's gone, it stayed flat through 2010, and it's just hockey sticked up over the last 3 or 4 years. And so a lot of these jobs are still to come. A lot of these good manufacturing jobs still are in the pipeline and are being incubated and worked on once these factories come online, whether they be semiconductor chips, solar panels, EV batteries, EVs, things in the biotech world. And a lot of the industries of the future that we can really have a lot of influence and success and try to make sure that these new things that a lot of people will need are made here in the United States.
Folks, that's Will Raglin. He's the Vice President of Research, Advocacy, and Outreach at the Center for American Progress's Action Fund. We're talking today about Donald Trump's broken promises to manufacturing. And Will, what I think is really critical here is not only did Donald Trump break his promises to the American worker and to the manufacturing industry across sectors here in the United States. And I want to make sure that we hit some of these statistics before we close out to make sure everybody's got the facts right. But not only did he break the promise that no manufacturing plants will close, many did, right? There's 170,000 fewer jobs at the end of the Trump administration than when he began. GM closed 5 North American plants. Thousands of jobs in the Rust Belt moved overseas. But it wasn't just the breaking of the promise. And some conservatives may say, oh, well, COVID happened and, you know, all this economic constriction. He incentivized the closure of manufacturing plants. He made it easier. He enabled the offshoring of good paying American union jobs. He encouraged that through his tax cuts for big corporations and the wealthiest people, as well as NAFTA 2.0. He didn't just break the promise. It was him actively taking steps, his biggest accomplishments that many people like to say they were fans of the Tax Cut Act. When in reality, it hurt the middle class, and it especially hurt American manufacturing. That, to me, is what is really pernicious here. It's not just the broken promise. It was the flat-out lying to the American people and then going and putting in place legislation that incentivized manufacturing to move overseas. It cost hundreds of thousands of jobs. Donald Trump did that. What are some of the other key statistics, Will, I think, that make this so plain?
Yeah, so one of the things that I always find the most interesting is, especially since he always talks about in his campaign stump and in 2016 and 2020 and today, is the bringing back of American jobs. When during his first term, we even before COVID hit, we saw over 150,000 jobs moved overseas. And that was in large part because of his trade policies and his tax policies. They kind of go hand in hand. His tax policies, while bringing the overall rate down for corporations, also brought their rate down on foreign profits to zero. So what did that make them do?
Yeah, I want to emphasize.
They made them move overseas. Yeah.
Yes, that is the key, right? Well, when you reduce the tax rate on profits made abroad or in foreign countries to zero, it creates an incentive for an American-based manufacturing company to close manufacturing here and to open it up somewhere else because they don't have to pay tax on the profit that's created overseas. There is no question that Donald Trump knew that that would be the result. Zero question, because it's a simple cause and effect. It's a tax dodge, and he knew that, and he advocated for that anyways. When you look at, again, the baseline, and again, we'll find, and I'll put up the Federal Reserve St. Louis link to the very hockey stick chart that you're talking about, because I'm an economist, and I love the nerdy things, and I want to share it with each and every one of you that are listening. But this is really simple. Under Trump's watch, Wisconsin lost 6,000 manufacturing jobs. Since President Biden and Vice President Harris took over, through a combination of the American Rescue Plan Act, the CHIPS Act, the Inflation Reduction Act, and the bipartisan infrastructure bill, Wisconsin has added 178,000 jobs. So the loss of 6,000 manufacturing jobs under Donald Trump, the addition of 178,000 jobs since Vice President Harris and President Biden took over. I mean, that's the story, right?
Well, yeah, just one quick thing, clarification on that. So the 178,000 is overall. But in Wisconsin, you know, it's been close to 15 to 20,000 since they've come back. So that's a good chunk. The Biden-Harris administration has made a lot of headway in trying to bring back manufacturing, but there's still a long way to go too. In the early aughts, in the late 90s, the manufacturing sector just took a massive hit. And it's interesting when you look back at recessions in the past, you see the manufacturing industry dip and not really make a rebound. Yeah. So, you know, the late 90s, the early aughts, we had, you know, boom and bust cycles where the manufacturing sector never really bounced back to anywhere near where it was. Same thing in 2008. And then what happened with COVID, where we saw another massive, you know, downturn, we not only have, we've rebounded and yes, we've come back really strong. And we're making the products for the future, that not only are, bringing back those manufacturing jobs, in a lot of cases, through the incentives that this administration has put forward, they're good union jobs. So yes. I think that's a really important key part to all of this.
Yeah, it's good paying middle class family supporting jobs, be they union jobs especially, but good paying jobs across the country. Again, that was 178,000 jobs created across the country under Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. Folks, we're going to come back with Will Ragland from the Center for American Progress Action Fund. He's the VP of Research, Advocacy, and Outreach. You are a worker in Wisconsin. You want to keep it locked because Donald Trump breaks promises to those that work in manufacturing and Wisconsinites, and he's going to do it again. Keep it locked here on the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome if you're just joining us. My name is Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. My very special guest this half hour is Will Ragland from the Center for American Progress Action Fund. He's the VP of Research, Advocacy, and Outreach. We're talking about manufacturing. And Will, I wanted to just take it up a level because, you know, I'm an economist, and economists will argue all the time about what is the exact right way to measure the health of the manufacturing industry. And you can look at output numbers, the job numbers get revised. There's lots of different ways to sort of dice and splice these numbers. And I think a lot of times candidates sort of argue around the edges, or they'll measure over certain periods of time. But one of the things that you said before we went to break, I thought was really important. And that is making sure that our manufacturing sector is going to be healthy and robust moving into the future, right? And I think that again, this is not about replacing some kinds of traditional, especially auto and manufacturing, other manufacturing jobs, but it's about sort of the D, all of the above approach, right? We want to support good family supporting manufacturing jobs in a state like Wisconsin. And we also want to make sure that our industry and our manufacturing sectors are ready for the next new wave of products. And so I wanted to focus in there. That was point one from a bigger picture perspective. And I'd like you to address that. Point two to me is, it seems a bit disingenuous for Donald Trump to be claiming that he supports manufacturing when he doesn't engage policies that actually help the middle class. In other words, especially tax and wage reform that is directly beneficial to the middle class, doesn't rely on some basically the big lie of trickle down, right? That acknowledges that if we want the middle class to do well, to consume the products that the manufacturing industry produces, we need to make sure that our tax system is fair. Will, if you could address both of those points about building the resiliency of our manufacturing sector, and also that all of this truly is about supporting middle class families.
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head. You know, It is an all of the above approach. You know, we want to continue to make all the products, especially normal automobiles. You know, there's a notion on the right that there's this mandate that you know, we're going to get rid of all internal combustion engines. That's not the case, but it is the case that we don't want to cede the EV manufacturing and market to the Chinese. We want to make those here. We want to manufacture the parts, the components, the materials in the United States. And I think that there is a huge opportunity to do that and make that an American-led, an American-dominant economy that helps support middle-class jobs. Same goes for chips, yes. Computer chips. This is an industry that we used to be a leader in, where we made close to 40% of the world's computer chips. That went down to about 12%. Well, with the new resurgence of AI and all this need for computing power, there's another opportunity to take the lead here. And in a bipartisan piece of legislation called the CHIPS Act that was roundly supported by both Democrats and Republicans and signed into the law by President Biden, we put a significant investment into this that was met by private industry, whether it be Intel in Ohio or Micron in Syracuse, New York, or the TSMC in Arizona. They're building these massive, massive plants to help build these chips again here in the United States. And there's all kinds of things that are being felt downstream from that that will again spur manufacturing here with the products of the future to make sure that we can be a manufacturing superpower once again. And I think that's really the smart way. We also can play catch up in some of the more traditional yes. sectors of manufacturing. That's not it's not an either or approach, but there's just such a huge opportunity for these products of the future, like you had talked about, that that we can really, really capitalize on in the near future. And I think we are. Yes. It's really been cool to see over the past 3 years that a lot of these manufacturing hubs and plants and chip hubs start to spring up, but it's going to take time.
You got to plant those seeds. There is a necessarily symbiotic relationship about helping to support and get our manufacturing sector ready for the products and the innovations of tomorrow while supporting traditional manufacturing today. We got a question from a listener, Gary, very briefly from Central Wisconsin. What is your question or comment, sir?
Well, I'm pretty sure I heard the number that, like, probably in year four, Trump's presidency, Wisconsin lost 6,000, I heard it emphasized that, manufacturing jobs. Now, in like some 3 years and 9 months almost now, Biden-Harris, like 100,000 plus have returned. You know, now we got to consider, of course, that was year one of the pandemic in which the Democrats totally manipulated and played around with and restricted everybody, stay at home, can't.
Yeah, Gary, your point's taken. It's why I began this segment by saying there are lots of different ways to measure this, but the readiness of manufacturing and the treatment of middle-class people fairly under the tax code must be part of our solution. My thanks to Will Ragland, Vice President of Research, Advocacy, and Outreach at the Center for American Progress Action Fund. We're joined by the CAPAF every Monday at 2:30. Thanks so much. Well, we're going to be back with Maggie and the Millionaires, Talking Money with Sarah Chase, a world-traveled reporter who's also advised on national security issues, talking about corruption and what it looks like in the modern era. Keep it locked. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network. Thanks, Will.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.